So I'd like to welcome everyone to the afternoon session of the Engineering Biology Research Consortium retreat. We have four great talks lined up for you today, but before we get to those talks, I want to spend just a minute or two talking about what EBRC is, our membership, and a little bit about what we plan to do moving forward. And so, first, what is EBRC? EBRC is the Engineering Biology Research Consortium. This is a consortium of academic, industrial, and government members focused on advancing synthetic biology. We aim to be the leading organization in the US to bring this community together and to showcase cutting-edge research, develop roadmaps for compel the field, and to move forward, and to align vision and goals with pressing national and global needs, and really focus those and combine them with a push out to the U.S. government and governments around the world when it comes to funding, assessing, and looking at synthetic biology and biotechnology research more broadly. And so that is sort of the point here. We want to bring this to the funders, to the policymakers, and to the broader community so that we're able to coalesce around some of these ideas and really focus on the cutting edge of early research and development. I want to spend just a second talking about EBRC's membership and how this group has come together. As many of you know, EBRC is the follow-on organization, the follow-on nonprofit to SynBERC, the Synthetic Biology Engineering Research Center, which brought together a really stellar group of academic investigators and industrial members. And EBRC is really continuing in that tradition. We're moving forward to expand the academic membership to include universities that weren't part of the previous iteration of SynBERC, and include investigators in a wide array of fields. And I'll mention some of the new members here in a moment. As with previous, institutional members are invited to join. We have a stellar group of members from a variety of companies and government agencies, and we anticipate seeing that grow significantly in the first year as part of the transition from SynBERC to the EBRC. And part of what we will be doing is supporting activities relevant to the synthetic biology research community and bringing those and pushing those out to the group. So I'd just like to take a moment and recognize the current institutional and government membership of EBRC. At the moment, the National Science Foundation is the only government member, but we anticipate that growing very, very shortly. And the 10 plus companies you see here are really sort of the first to the post, and I anticipate these logos getting smaller and many, many more companies coming on board over the next several months. I also want to include the academic affiliations of EBRC's academic members, just to show the diversity of who we have here and who we've been able to bring together to talk about and focus on synthetic biology and engineering biology research. And for a moment, I'd like to focus on some of the new members that have come on board. As I mentioned earlier in this retreat, we really have a stellar group of 10 new members whose pictures are shown here, and we plan to expand this membership by approximately 10 every year going forward. And so, without further ado, I'd like to first thank Caltech for hosting us here today, and turn the podium over to Richard Murray, who is going to serve as chair of this session for the four great talks we have coming up. So, thank you.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, Richard. Again, I'm Ashty Karim, and I'm really excited to share with you today the work that we've done in Mike Jewett's lab at Northwestern to develop a cell-free framework for rapid biosynthetic pathway prototyping, in which we can now test pathways of enzymes in vitro, but in the context of native metabolism, in parallel and in a high throughput fashion. This is important because, as many of you know, it takes a really long time once you've identified a pathway to put it inside cells, and this research time it's time consuming. So the number of biochemicals that we can make industrial is growing, and the complexity is also increasing. So from the production of 1,3-propanediol to the production of artemisinin, we've gotten really good at being able to build some of these molecules inside microbes. The problem is that the research time is slow, often taking many person years, 10 to hundreds of person years of research to develop these. And we can see why this might be the case if we look at how we build a pathway. So let's say you have a molecule of interest that you want to make. In this case, let's think about butanol, a potential alternative fuel. Once you have that molecule or know what you want to make, you might choose a host organism that has beneficial metabolic schemes, like glycolysis, that allows you to go from central carbon metabolism and build up a pathway to get to butanol. Your next step would be to choose the enzymes that catalyze each of these steps, either from databases of enzymes that you might be able to find, or in vitro purified enzyme kinetics. And so once you've identified enzymes to build this pathway, you'd go into cells and build that. In my hands, I might have these enzymes, construct the plasmids and operons that are needed. That might take a week. Fine-tune the expression of each of those proteins here. That might take another week, several optimizations later, a few more weeks, and if all goes well, which it rarely does, in about a month I could test for a positive result, only to find that it didn't work. And that's for one pathway that you might want to try. In reality, you want to try lots of different enzymes. So for example, in this six-step pathway, you might want to try five enzymes, enzyme variants for each of these. So in your database or catalog of enzymes, there are thousands that you can choose from. So you might want to try five for each, and if you look at the combinatorial space there, you're reaching over 15,000 possible combinations, and that's not even looking at various levels or expression levels of each of these enzymes. And so current pipelines today of how we engineer cells, it's just not feasible to try these combinations. And I like to look at this dilemma, or how we build pathways like this, as if we were trying to pick out the perfect outfit for a specific occasion. So let's say the EBRC retreat. So you might go shopping, try on the necessary pants, shirt, and shoes to find a perfect outfit, but you're really limited to the stores that you can actually go to. Just like many of you want more efficient ways to go shopping and find this outfit, there's a clear and pressing need to generate the tools to start screening or prototyping enzymes and pathways at a greater scale. So in cells, while it is feasible to try a few combinations, cell-free systems are like the online shopping of biosynthetic pathway engineering. Rather than being limited to box stores, we now have Amazon. We can order 50 different articles of clothing, try on lots of different combinations, return what we don't want, and we're left with a perfect outfit. This provides the capability to drastically increase the amount of pathways that we can test. Cell-free systems are unique in that all you need is DNA, cell extract, and cell-free reagents, which don't need to be redesigned, reconstructed, or remade to test new pathways. The way that this works is that we take E. coli cells, we grow them up as they make metabolic enzymes, transcriptional machinery, and ribosomes, and we spin them down to remove genomic DNA and cellular debris, and we're left with a crude cell lysate. With this lysate, we can perform a variety of different functions. And in that way, we're able, cell-free systems uniquely decouple cellular objectives, so their ability to grow and make these enzymes, and our engineering objectives of them or wanting to make some of these products. The most notable function of cell-free systems is using it for cell-free protein synthesis, where you provide DNA for a protein that you want to make, cell-free reagents in the extract, and you're able to make a protein. Our lab has extensive research in this area where we've created really productive systems to make proteins as well as find out that ATP regeneration and cofactor regeneration is present in the lysates. This lays the foundation for being able to use these crude lysates for metabolic convergence to make a molecule like butanol. The advantages are reduced cell viability constraints that I already talked about. They don't have to grow while you're trying to use them to do a function. There's an open reaction environment. We're in a test tube. We can add different chemicals and manipulate the system in different ways. And the pathways that we want to try are easy to manipulate. So my work has focused on building this approach and validating it using the glucose to butanol pathway as shown here. The idea is that the crude cell lysate will have native E. coli metabolism, so glycolysis is here, to go from glucose to acetyl-CoA. And then we're using a clostridia-derived CoA-dependent six-step pathway from acetyl-CoA to get to butanol. And so these are the enzymes that we've chosen here for those steps. So there are six steps, but five different enzymes that catalyze it. And so our approach is basically we take each of these enzymes, the DNA that encodes it, put it on individual plasmids, selectively overexpress each enzyme in a separate strain, make lysates out of each of those strains, and now we're left with five extracts that have selectively overexpressed enzymes. We can observe these on protein gels so that we can see that we do have selectively overexpressed enzymes in each extract, and then we can mix the five extracts together, thereby reconstituting the entire butanol pathway, add glucose and cofactors, incubate, and over a 24-hour period, we can see that we can activate the butanol biosynthetic pathway. So if we look at the timescales comparing to what I would do in a cell versus what I'm able to do with this cell-free metabolic engineering or CFME approach, we can reduce the time by a third here, as I've described. So plasmid construction takes less time because you no longer have to worry about RBSs, promoters, and putting things in operons, and you don't need to express multiple proteins in a single cell. The problem here is it still utilizes the need to express enzymes in cells. If there were a way that we could bypass that, we would really reduce the time that we can test all these pathways of enzymes. And so I propose here that we use cell-free protein synthesis to make the enzymes in vitro for the pathway and then add glucose to activate that metabolic conversion, further reducing the time. So like we did with the CFME approach, with the CFPSME approach, we validated it for the production of butanol. So what I'm showing you here is we took the five mixed extract system that contain all of the enzymes for butanol, except for the non-native entry enzyme, so this HBD enzyme down here in the pathway. We don't add that extract. Then we add the DNA for that missing enzyme, as well as CFPS components, and we can see that in this mixed extract system, we can make the HBD enzyme. So here, we're measuring this by radioactive C14 leucine incorporation into the protein as it's being produced. And so now that we know we can use the mixed extract system to make the proteins or the enzymes, we can now couple that with the metabolic conversion. By adding glucose after 3 hours of cell-free protein synthesis, we can make the HBD enzyme, thereby activating the entire pathway and producing butanol. So this is one enzyme in the system. What you'd really like to do is build the entire pathway completely in vitro. And so to get at that, we've tried going and building from each enzymatic node in the pathway. So here I'm showing one enzyme with mixed extract system with all the other enzymes present, and I'm showing 24 hours butanol production here. So as you do two enzymes in the extract, you can still make butanol. Three enzymes, four, and five in one pot. You can see that as we increase the number of enzymes that we have to make in vitro, we decrease the amount of butanol that we can make. The nice thing about the cell-free system is if you come to this point and you're not making any butanol, or at least not detecting it, you can easily change protein expression by changing the amount of DNA that you add to the system. So what we did here was we took extract with the first four enzymes in the pathway, fixed concentrations of DNA, and then we increase the amount of the last enzyme DNA that we add in each of these cases, and as we increase the last enzyme, we're able to recover the butanol phenotype. So because we can do this, we can now play around with protein expression levels without having to reconstruct DNA or make new extract. But the really cool thing is if we could try different variants of enzymes, which is how I motivated this entire technology. And so what we did is we found through gene alignments four proposed bifunctional enzymes. So these were predicted to have HBD and CRIT functionality, so the second and third step in the pathway. And so we have three cases here. One where we have the five mixed extracts missing the HBD enzyme, one missing the CRIT enzyme, and one missing both the second and third HBD and CRIT enzymes. By adding linear templates of the proposed bifunctional enzymes and performing CFP-SME, we can test here for HBD functionality. So does that bifunctional enzyme have HBD functionality, CRIT functionality, and bifunctionality? And so here I'm showing butanol production for each of these cases, and each of the four bifunctional or proposed bifunctional enzymes are indeed bifunctional, except for the last one. It only has HBD functionality. So this is a way that we can start looking at proteins or enzymes that have multiple functions in ways that is pretty slow in cells if you tried to do. And so CFP-SME bypasses in vivo expression of enzymes, and now we can use linear DNA templates to activate biosynthetic pathways. So this is cool, and you can imagine that we could start testing lots of different variants, but the overall goal, I think, is to select pathway designs and be able to inform some sort of cellular expression of these biosynthetic pathways. So we need to ask the question, what is the relationship between our crude lysates and cellular systems? We know that they don't equal each other because cells are a little more complex. They have dynamical regulation, and that just isn't present in our crude lysates. But we also know that it's not unequal because for decades, people have used in vitro biochemical characterizations of enzymes to inform their biosynthetic pathway designs in cells. Pretty recently, Jim Liao's group at UCLA used in vitro studies to develop the non-oxidative glycolysis. And so this, we can see that this has been used over and over with purified enzymes. And so there's evidence to believe that there is a correlation here. And if we can find what that is, then we can start manipulating the systems to better address how we can inform cellular expression. So one way we can do that is we can easily manipulate this environment to change metabolism. So how we do that is we vary the physiochemical conditions that are happening in our reactions. So we're using Agilent liquid handling robots to vary concentrations of all the chemical components that are added to our system. So salts, glucose, phosphate, and cofactors. We vary each of those individually and then add our five mixed extract system, incubate, and we can observe butanol over time. So each of these bars shows a unique physiochemical condition. So one component is being changed. The black bar is where we started. If you look at the high ends and the low ends, because of how we set this up, one component is responsible for that, varying that concentration. So we can see that NAD and CoA are responsible for both of these, so varying the amount of butanol that can be made. We can then use these robotic experiments to inform further experiments and do more extensive optimizations of these cofactors. So on the x-axis, I'm showing you an increase in NAD concentration, y-axis increase in CoA, and we're measuring butanol here. And so you can see that there seems to be an optimal balance between NAD and CoA in our systems to make the maximum amount of butanol. If you have too much, you're not getting a lot of butanol, and too little, you're not getting a lot of butanol. This makes sense because in the pathway, butanol to make butanol, it's highly NADH dependent, and you need CoA to be able to have flux go through the acetyl-CoA node. You can also look at the byproducts that are made. So here I'm showing you lactate and acetate in a similar fashion, and they have different dependencies on NAD and CoA. And so you can start manipulating the pathways not just by changing enzyme variants, but also the physiochemical conditions. And so if we use this to optimize our cell-free butanol production, we see metabolic profiles that look like this. So again, this is the five mixed extract system. Black is glucose, and we're measuring butanol, lactate, and acetate. And so as glucose is consumed, we have an increase in lactate and then a decrease in lactate over time. So this is all in our CFME system, so no in vitro enzyme synthesis. When we couple that with the CFPS, or the cell-free protein synthesis, we get a very different metabolic profile. And so actually, over time, you get an increase of lactate, and you don't get that decrease. but we can use what we learned from the physicochemical optimizations of NAD and CoA to change the reaction environment to more closely mimic what we saw in CFME. So this shows proof of concept that we can alter these metabolic profiles so that we can match two different systems to each other, and it lays the foundation to be able to start matching these to cellular metabolism. You can imagine matching cellular metabolism during log phase, during stationary phase. There's a lot that you can do with these systems. So what I hope that I showed you today was that the design build test cycles for biochemical production are slow. We just can't test enough variants of pathways quickly enough. And so what we've done is we've developed an approach called cell-free protein synthesis-driven metabolic engineering to select and optimize pathway designs without having to re-engineer or redesign DNA or organisms. And what we're working on now is trying to ask this question, what is that relationship between our crude lysates and cells, so that we can get cell-free informed pathway construction and operation. With that, I'd like to acknowledge my advisor, Mike Jewett, Quentin Dudley, who also works on metabolism in my lab, trying to go into isoprenoids, Dr. Jian Li, who's a postdoc, who's working on non-ribosomal peptides, two undergrads that made a lot of this work possible, and a postdoc that was in our lab, Dr. Filippo Cascara, who worked on the robot, liquid handling robot with me. Funding sources, and then, of course, EBRC. So thank you.
Okay, so we have a little bit of time for questions for Ashty. Okay, way in the back. Wait till you get the mic.
You talked about optimization of pathways that you then put inside organisms. What about just using cell-free systems for producing molecules without an organism at all?
Okay, so that's a good question. So in our lab, we've sort of had two approaches for biochemical production and actually using these as a way to do that, or a prototyping framework. And there are companies working on trying to scale up cell-free systems. Problems that we have is the time scales of our reactions. You didn't really see it, or you might have seen it, they kind of stop over that 24-hour period. There's something happening in our system. So there's a lot of optimization that needs to go into it. So where we think it's pretty powerful is being able to describe pathways and give more informed kinetic parameters that you could use to engineer cells.
Okay. Other questions for Ashty?
Hi, well, I like the idea of trying to figure out how to mimic the cellular conditions, but I wonder if you could go the other way around, and that is engineer the cell to more closely mimic your in vitro system, or what are there things that you could do to create an organismal chassis that looks more like the kind of prototyping that you
do? Yeah, I'll just give you an example to try to address that question. With our NAD and CoA optimizations, we found that actually pretty high levels of NAD and CoA are required to get our maximal production in the cell-free system. Those levels are just not possible inside cells. So what you could do is take that information and try to express enzymes that might alter that cofactor balance inside the cells to more closely mimic that.
Other questions? Okay, great. Let's thank Ashty again. Okay, our next speaker in the session is Sarah from JB.
So, hi, I'm Sarah LaFrance. I'm with Nathan Hillson's group at JBay. And this talk's going to be a little bit different from some of the other ones you've been hearing about the research. I'll be presenting some of our software tools that we've developed at the lab to further support research. So I'll be talking about five of our tools that are either open source or are going to be open source as soon as we get sort of licensing and all that sort of thing worked out. The five tools that I'm going to cover today are ICE, the inventory of composable elements. It's one of our most popular pieces of software. We have, I think, over 700 users. It's publicly available now, and this is sort of a strain archive database for different pieces of DNA. DIVA is the DNA design, implementation, verification, and automation. This is for researchers to keep track of their sort of PCR in the lab, if it's being constructed, if the design was rejected, if there are problems with it, to sort of go back and forth with the people in the lab to stay on top of their different projects and designs. Device editor and vector editor are also fully open source and available now. These are tools for designing and constructing small pieces of DNA. And last is one of our newest tools, the Experiment Data Depot, which is sort of what it sounds like is a big database for experiments that are finished, to sort of put all of your experiment procedures, all of your lab notebook data, all of that sort of thing into one big database that everyone can sort of get to. Those three open source tools, ICE, Device Editor, and Vector Editor, are up now on GitHub. Anyone here can fork them, download them, look through the code. Those are up now. The other two should be coming later on. Our goals with sort of these tools and our goals with opening them up to everyone is to sort of get more science, to open up science more, bring everybody's data out so that people aren't doing the same experiments over and over again, reproducing results that other people are working on. One of our other goals is to sort of increase collaboration and communication. So, for example, in our lab, we have people at the JGI, people at Sandia, who aren't necessarily physically in the lab, but who need to communicate with strain archivists or people who are constructing DNA. And all of these sort of create roadblocks when you're trying to do your science, as well as trying to keep researchers focused on their research. Right now, we have a lot of people who have a whole lot of education, a whole lot of knowledge about biology, very smart people who want to work on hard problems, but they're spending all this time doing essentially data entry, where you're copy-pasting, you know, maybe big CSV files here and there and attaching them to emails, sending them to people. And these sort of things are really kind of tedious, time-consuming. And tedious and time-consuming is not what we want to waste a bunch of, you know, very smart people's time on. Boring, simple, and tedious is what computers do really well. So we're trying to automate as much of that boring housekeeping stuff as possible so that researchers can be back in the lab where they want to be. So the first tool is the inventory of composable elements. We have a public version at publicregistry.jbay that I believe all you have to do is put in your email and you'll have access to the public version of the strain archive. So, yes, it's gonna play. This is just sort of a demonstration of what the JBay version of the strain archive looks like. You can see all the different strains. These are all plasmids. That's primarily what we work with at JBay, doing our biofuels research. And you can see on the left side the different registries at different organizations. If we go into one of these strains, we have information about the PI, about creators, the organism that that strain is in. If you have questions about the strain, if you need to talk to people about it, that's who you're going to contact. I'm going to skip ahead with this. If you scroll down a little bit, there's a visualization of the plasmid, which is in vector editor, which we'll get to later. You can also download GenBank files, SBOL files, so that you don't need to worry about having those files to hand. You can always just go get a new one in the format you want. ICE will also convert between different formats of those files. One of the main functions of ICE, though, is tracking the physical location of these strains in our strain archive and being able to order samples of those strains from the lab directly from the computer. In this case, these are in a tube sitting somewhere. If we go look at this other strain that we have in the archive, you can see when it gets to it. That we have three samples, and this will show the exact plate, the exact well on that plate where it's located. So this site is also accessible by our archivists, and so these magical numbers I don't understand, but the people who handle the actual samples will be able to look at that, go to the exact refrigerator or freezer or shelf where it is, know exactly where that well is. It saves everybody a lot of time. The other great thing about ICE is everyone who's talking about a strain is talking about the exact same sort of canonical item. When you publish papers, things like that, you can reference a strain and put the link to ICE in the paper. That way everyone who reads it knows exactly where to go. Everyone's talking about the same exact data. So a little bit about the organization of this data in this part. You can sort of collect your own personal strains. You can see I selected these to put in my own personal folder just to show you some of the permissions. Now say I have these strains that I'm dealing with and I want to share these links that are inside JBay with somebody I'm collaborating with outside of JBay. Because I have permission to do that, I can go in here and on this folder I can add an entire organization, say everyone at JBay. So anyone who has access to the JBay registry can now look at this folder. They can look at these strains. Because of the web of registries, which is sort of an interconnected group of a bunch of different registries, if I know someone's email address, I can also give them access to these strains. So this just makes it easier for people working in different locations. Maybe they don't have access to the entire JBay registry, but if you need to work with someone at Stanford on a certain strain, you don't have to download the whole sequence, attach it, email it to them, have them download it, and put it into their registry. You just say, here's the link, and everybody's on the same page. This is me. I could only share it with myself because I don't have permissions for anyone else, it turns out. But when you set the permissions, you can see nice graphical interface. You can see exactly who's allowed to access this folder, whether sometimes they can just read it or if they can edit those strains. So this is one way that we're encouraging sort of collaboration and taking some of that extra, you know, attachment spam pain out of dealing with people who are at all different locations. Because at JBay, because we're a joint venture, we have people in all different physical locations around the country. So in our web of registries that I talked about, these are sort of, I think these are all of the participating people. Of course, Sinberg is sort of deprecated at the bottom there, but so we have people from all over the country, from Canada, from the UK, and they all sort of have their own version of this registry and can share and collaborate with anyone who's on the other registries. So that's great for DNA that we already have in the archive, but for designing and implementing new DNA, we're going to talk about DIVA, which is the Design Implementation Verification and Automation Tool. So DIVA, if you have ever used Jira to manage sort of tickets and software, I don't know how many software people are here, it's basically a way of making a little job and then tracking the status of that job as it bounces around between different people. So this really cuts down on a lot of angry emails and confusion between people who are constructing your DNA, people who are designing the DNA, people who want to order it from the lab. So we can see here on Nathan's sort of mock-up of the homepage, there's no public version of DIVA right now, so this is a little bit of an artistic render. You could have multiple different projects that are run by different people, and you can easily update everyone in the group on this page. So you can see everyone's activity, you can check on the status of your different projects. So if we go down into these designs, designs for different small pieces of DNA can go through these different stages where they're drafted, they're sent to the lab to be approved and constructed, or you can see some of them are waiting on reagents maybe. If the design has been entirely rejected with a reason of this is too expensive, this is too many fragments, this isn't going to work, please try again and send it back. But it tracks the status of each of these designs as they sort of go through this pipeline. This is just sort of a nice, friendly user face or user interface that everybody is on the same page. So where do these designs come from? Our tool Device Editor is attached to DIVA. You can see This is sort of a modular, sort of building block way of designing pieces of DNA out of sort of modular building block parts. What device editor does is it sort of gives you a little symbolic representation of each of these things that you might be putting in sequence. It also calculates the combinatorial properties. So you can see at some of these locations, you may want to swap between, in this case, only two different things, but you can stack as many different features or promoters as you'd like. It will then go ahead and generate, in this case, we've got, what, 2^3, so the 8 sequences that you've ordered the different combinations of. Device editor also has logic where if you wanted a promoter to in one location in the strand on some of your DNA and in a different location, you can tell it to exclude any of the combinations that have two promoters or that have no promoters. So you can exclude some of the combinations. Device editor will also try to warn you when you're doing something kind of foolish as far as just throwing those different features together. Another great feature is you can see at the bottom, it will estimate the cost of that construction based on number of fragments, length of fragments, and the assembly strategy that you chose. So you can, generally these are sent to the lab and the lab will decide what to do with them, but you can specifically request certain assembly strategies. And the lab can also send it back and say, that's ridiculous, we're not making several hundred dollars worth of DNA for you. Please pick something else. So these parts, you can either get from, you can paste the sequence in directly, you can use GenBank files. It will also talk to ICE, so you can go into ICE and get a part number, drop it in, and it will render out that part for you. Designs can be saved here and stored in your account on Diva. So one of our other design tools is Vector Editor, which is sort of that preview visualizer that you saw when we were looking at ICE. There's a read-only version and an edit version. So the read-only version gives you a nice visualization of, in our case, mostly plasmids again, and gives you information about all the features, cut sites, enzymes, the reading frames, and that sort of thing on your piece of DNA. The edit functionality also lets you go in and sort of copy-paste features around. So this is what Vector Editor looks like running inside of ICE. If we go to our ICE entry and we actually go and open up the full screen version. So the old version of Vector Editor was the one that you saw before. That was in Flash. We've completely rebuilt both Vector Editor and Device Editor just starting from scratch in JavaScript. Because the old Flash version is no longer being supported. Modern browsers, because it's such a security hazard, are kind of shutting down a lot of the abilities of Flash. It's not allowed to get to files. It's not allowed to access the clipboard. So the Flash version was getting clunkier and sort of losing its ability to do things, and soon Flash isn't going to be around at all. The other great thing about the JavaScript version is that it can run on multiple devices. So our lab is moving more towards tablets instead of laptops. Bringing them into the lab is just safer because they're sealed up. Things aren't going to invade the keyboard, and so Flash doesn't run on a tablet at all. These can work on tablets, on smartphones, on any device. And because the technology is newer and better, we've got a much nicer resolution, which didn't really translate to the video on this slide, but the visualizations have very nice resolution, and what a lot of people use this for is to save a copy, a really nice copy of the visualization and print that out and put it on a poster. Because you can zoom in on parts, because it's an SVG, it won't lose resolution. This video is just running through some of the editing abilities that we have. Our enzyme groups that are stored in it, you can preview what different enzyme groups where they will cut. You can look at features, you can delete features, copy-paste them into different parts. This sequence panel, you can go in and type into as though it were a text editor, and it'll just put those base pairs in. Anything you do here will save back to the entry in ICE. So if you need to make a new entry in ICE that's a little bit different from an old one, you can sort of put the old sequence in and then just tweak a few things to save that variation. And from here, you can also get the SBOL GenBank and different file formats. So the very last tool I'm going to go over is our newest tool, and it doesn't really have a cute logo yet, so it's just the experiment data depot. And this tool, Tracy Lopez presented a poster on it yesterday. So I'm just going to kind of go over it quickly. It's very much what it sounds like. We're trying to open up a lot of science, open source people's results. When you publish a paper, you can take all of your experimental data, go ahead and just dump it into the data depot. What we're trying to do is bring sort of some engineering ideas to biology, where things are a little more standardized, where the data structure is more standard, and everyone's sort of working with the same same processes and same procedures. That way we can compare. You can see at the bottom there's multiple experiments run by maybe different people at different times and different labs, and we can compare those results to one another and look at the metadata. So this can, when you're beginning a new experiment, you can go back and look and see, has anyone done this before? Has anyone done something similar? What were their results like? You can compare the behavior of your data with past assays on the same types of things. The other benefit of this is that right now, sometimes people come into the lab, they run their experiments, they take all their lab notebooks, and they leave. And that data is just gone. So if you come through JBay and you do some research, we have your data. We don't have to chase you down to other organizations and email you. What we're hoping to do with this in the future is to make this very automated, to the point where we're trying to get it to automatically draw data from instruments, from photospectrophotometers, and from different sort of machines like that, so that all the researcher has to do is set it up, push the button, walk away, and EDD will tell them, oh, your data is ready, and here it is. You don't have to deal with some of the clunkier interfaces that some of these machines have. You don't have to do command line processing or convert things from one format to another, because people copy-pasting stuff from an Excel file into another file into another, you're introducing a lot of possibility for error. It's very boring. It's very repetitive. It would be much nicer if you could just hit the button and let the computer do it all for you. One of the other things that we're very excited about is the possibility of feeding, once we have a big data backlog here, of feeding it into a machine learning sort of system that will be able to guide future work towards different assays, different areas that are likely to produce actionable results. So as Ashty was talking about, you have maybe thousands of possible combinations. We hope that the EDD will be able to look back at previous research and say, well, here are the assays that you should try to do first. These are likely to give you good results. So that's sort of our future pie in the sky hopes for the EDD. But right now we're in the process of collecting data and making it more available for everyone to look at. A public version of the EDD and a public version of Diva should be coming out soon. But other than that, thanks to everybody at the lab. These are all the developers who work on all the tools, everybody who helped out with this presentation. If anyone has questions or comments, if anyone wants to download and work on those apps and give me feedback, I love feedback. Other than that, I can answer any questions. Thanks.
For Sarah. So, Sarah, can you say a little about interoperability with other tools that are out there? I mean, both, you know, DNA editors and plasmid editors and lots of other things. Is it sort of easy to, you know, work with this set of tools and your own tools, or really got to kind of adopt the whole set, or say a little about that?
Yeah, right now, our tools are designed to work with each other a lot. There's definitely other DNA editors out there. Right now, there's a lot of common file formats that right now, unfortunately, that's really the only way to go back and forth between them. And that's one of the things we're sort of working on, is to make more of a closed pipeline where you sort of start at one end, you go all the way through to getting results without having to, like I said, download a file and attach it to an email.
Great. Any other questions?
Yeah. So the data compiler looks great. And I think, you know, a bunch of us have actually been talking about having that exact thing available to researchers and how important that would be. So my only question really is, you said it's going to be available soon publicly. What could you give us a little bit more information on that, or and how we'd be able to get it, and if we could try out a copy now or that sort of thing?
Sure. I'm not actually on the team that's working on it. They're going to release it as soon as possible. I know that if your organization's interested, that's one thing I forgot to say, so thanks, is the EDD and DIVA. If you apply to the lab now, people have applied for licenses to use them. They're just not like open source, go ahead and download. But other organizations have been able to license them.
Cool, thank you.
Other questions? Okay, great. Let's thank Sarah again. Thank you very much. Okay, and our final speaker for the public session is Jay Keasling. Jay is a professor of lots of different things. Chemistry and biomolecular engineering at Berkeley, chemical and biomolecular engineering at Berkeley, bioengineering at Berkeley. He's also a senior staff scientist at JBay, or at Lawrence Berkeley Lab, CEO at JBay, PI on the grant that's brought us all here. Those are at least some of the many things that Jay does for us. So, Jay.
Thanks. It's a pleasure to be here. Let's just see if this comes up. I realized looking at the schedule that I have, well, it's on my screen, but it's not on yours. I just realized that I have an hour and 40 minutes, according to the schedule. So I was madly dumping things into my presentation to fill up the time slot. No, I'm not serious. It's really great to be here. It's great for many reasons. It's great because we have an excellent new organization that's funded by the U.S. government and companies. It's great because we have an excellent new leader on board with Doug Friedman. And it's especially great that I'm not responsible. even though I'm very proud of the organization, I'm happy not to answer NSF questions late before the last day. So today I'm going to talk about engineering polyketide synthases. And I first want to start off with something that I often start off with that you all probably know, and that is that oil provides nearly all of our fuels and almost all of the chemicals and materials that we use on a regular basis. And if you look at a typical barrel of oil, roughly 80 to 85% goes into all those fuels, and the other 15 to 20% goes into all the chemicals we use. And the list is really extensive. It's things like carpet, it's things like paint, fabrics, deodorants, all kinds of things made from petroleum, either in part or in whole. And so we've really become addicted to petroleum. It's going to eventually run out. We'd like to have some of the products that we currently make from petroleum made from a renewable resource. And we'd like to have even better products if we can, things that might be recyclable, reusable in a better way, and that would take less energy to produce. And so what we've been spending a lot of time in my laboratory thinking about is how we can produce some of these same products or replacements for those products that would be better using engineered biology. And we spent the last 9 years or more working kind of on this side of the slide, and we have some solutions there. I have to say that it's really hard to compete on this side of the slide because of the price of a barrel of oil. It's not easy to compete on this part of the slide because many of these products are still sold for very inexpensively, and we all enjoy those inexpensive products, but they are higher value than the fuels. Now, if we just look at the kind of molecules that are in fuels shown there on the right, they are pretty boring molecules. They're basically hydrocarbons, and they don't do anything under many conditions, but they explode under certain conditions. But why they're so boring, really, is because you don't want them reacting. You don't want them reacting in your tank. You don't want them reacting in pipes where they're being transported. You don't want them reacting in trucks or whatever. So that's why they are the way they are. Now, if you look on the left-hand side of the slide, you'll see a series of molecules that are used to make all of those products that we now get from petroleum. And they're a little more interesting. They've got some reactive groups in those. And those reactive groups are there because then you can take these molecules, you can polymerize them, you can dope them into things and make interesting products that are very useful. So we've been, over the last 10 years, been developing the chemistry to produce these molecules on the right. And most of those molecules can be produced from the fatty acid biosynthetic pathway or the isoprenoid biosynthetic pathway. And you saw some great examples over the last 2 days of those pathways in action and people using those. Now, on this side, it's a little more challenging to produce these exact molecules using those same pathways. There are examples out there where you can produce a few of these, but mostly fatty acids and isoprenoids don't have all of these interesting functional groups. There are a class of molecules that do have those interesting functional groups. They're called the polyketides. And polyketide synthases are responsible for producing these interesting molecules, many of which are antibiotics or other kinds of drugs. And probably everyone in this room has some familiarity with a polyketide because you've taken an antibiotic or some other polyketide-based drug at some time in your life. Now, certain classes of polyketide synthases are quite unique. They're called type 1 polyketide synthases. And an example is shown here. Now, you saw several great examples of talks today of metabolic pathways and yesterday. And in every case that I saw, those enzymes were single enzymes. They would have multiple enzymes in a pathway, but they would be functioning as a single isolated enzyme with a single activity. Polyketide synthases are interesting because it's like an entire metabolic pathway tethered together in a single protein. And those are shown here. So in this particular polyketide synthase, which is responsible for producing the core of erythromycin, there are two gigantic proteins, protein 1, 2, and 3 that you see there, and they have a series of modules in them. Now, those proteins are linked together inside the cell with linkers, which are short peptides that specifically bind together that keep these proteins stuck together. Now, the other interesting thing that you should know about these molecules is that the substrate is attached to the protein, and it moves along the protein. And at each module, it adds two carbons to the backbone, plus the associated functionality that goes with those two carbons. So as the molecule passes down the protein, then it gets two more carbons at each module, and it's just passed along that protein until it gets to the end. There's a loading module that initiates everything, loads on some molecule that starts the whole series of reactions, and then there are extension modules that extend it and add two carbons along until it gets to the termination module, which kicks it off the protein. Each one of those circles I've represented there are domains, and you can think about these as individual enzymes. And that tells you how big that protein is, because each one of those is like an individual enzyme in a metabolic pathway. Now, here's how the basic PKS works. I've got a load module, an extension module, and a termination module. So the load module loads on a two-carbon backbone subunit with any R group attached to it from a CoA. And the acyl transferase does that. It loads it onto the ACP. A similar acyl transferase in the extension module loads on a CoA onto its cognate ACP. And then the ketosynthase condenses those. You lose a carbon dioxide in that condensation, and you extend it by two carbons. And then the thioesterase kicks it off the protein, and you get your product. Now, you can, besides just having this base, you can have a ketoreductase, which reduces the keto group to an alcohol. You can have a ketoreductase and a dehydratase, which reduces the keto group and then removes a water. And then you can have an enoyl reductase with the ketoreductase and the dehydratase that reduce the double bond. So there you go. There's all the kinds of products you can produce from this simple, very basic PKS. Now, it turns out that they're not so simple or basic. It wasn't until about 2014, so 2 years ago, that we got our first glimpse of a module. We had gotten glimpses, structures of domains, but not of modules. So here's that very simple extension module that I showed you that's got a ketosynthase, an acyl transferase, a ketoreductase, and an ACP. And here it is right here. And you can see the protein. First of all, it exists as a dimer, so it's twice as big as those structures that I showed you. And what's interesting about it is this ACP, which has the substrate attached to it, moves around to the various active sites as they act on it, and then it moves to the next one and the next one, and then somehow magically it passes it on to the next module that follows. So, and this is the only one we really have right now, the only structure, but they're incredibly complicated molecular machines. Now, the other thing to know about them is they're hugely diverse. Almost every soil organism has a polyketide synthase in it. They're producing these polyketides, which are antibiotics. They're doing war against each other in the soil, in your guts, all over the place. And they produce diverse structures. And those structures, some of which you saw in those antibiotics, are produced by these modules. And I just show a sampling here of different load modules, different extension modules, and termination modules. But the main point here is that there's a huge amount of diversity that these polyketide synthases can catalyze. So polyketide synthases are unique enzymes whose sequence can be directly translated into a chemical structure. It's important. They're capable of producing diverse chemicals. They produce few off-target products because of how they make them. They have editing functions in those domains. So they edit off things that aren't proper, aren't the ones they want. And because it's a decarboxylative condensation, they always are moving forward. So there's very little reverse activity on these. And they have very specific synthesis traits in antibiotic producers that aren't too off fatty acid synthesis. So mainly what I'm trying to say here is they're faster than we have given them credit for. So the goals of our work are to determine the rules for recombining these to make any chemical that we want. And primarily we're looking at some very simple chemicals. We want to build hybrid PKS and NRPS proteins that produce valuable chemicals. And we want to construct a host that will allow us to produce these chemicals in large scale. So I'm going to give you some examples of some very simple PKSs that we've built in my lab over the last few years, and some rules that we've learned along the way that help us build more complicated PKSs down the road. So the first set of molecules we're going to talk about are polyesters. Huge amount of polyesters around. You're sitting on polyesters, the fabric on those chairs. They're in plastic bottles and a huge number of other things. So to make a polyester, you need an alcohol and you need an acid. And you condense those together and you get a polyester. So that's basically what we need. Now, if we want to try to produce the monomer using a PKS, we want to make cuts of two carbons, because remember, every module extends it by two carbons. I'm going to make the cut right here. And in order to produce that molecule, I'm going to hypothesize that I need a PKS that has a loading module, one extension module, and a termination module. And here's basically the chemistry it's going to catalyze. It's going to load on a CoA onto that ACP. It's going to load on a second CoA onto this ACP. It'll condense them together, reduce the keto to an alcohol, and then kick that off and give us our product. So then we had to go out and build this, actually. So here's the construct that we made. We took two well-known polyketide synthases. One is the lipomycin PKS, and the other is the erythromycin PKS. Both of these produce antibiotics, and they've been studied by many laboratories. So from the lipomycin PKS, we took the first two modules, the load and the first extension module, and we took the termination module from the erythromycin PKS. Now, as it turns out, the lipomycin PKS is interesting because it discriminates in all of the extension modules as it's going down and building the chain, but it has a lot of flexibility in what it will load on. And that actually is an advantage for us because that means that we can produce a lot of different polyesters. So the first thing we did is characterize how promiscuous that load module is, that acyl transferase. And so we tried various CoAs, they're shown here, and we characterized them in terms of their KCAT and KM, and you can see the kinetics here. Basically, it works for all of them pretty well, except for pivoyl CoA, which is an oddball anyway. We were trying to produce isooctane as a fuel. This didn't work very well for that, but it works pretty well for all of these other substrates. So then we built the PKS. We showed that we could load on all of these starting precursors except for pivoyl CoA, this oddball shown here at the bottom, and we get these various products. And what you'll notice is that every one of these products has a methyl group in the 2 position, and that's because this acyl transferase specifies that it has to be extended by a methyl malonyl CoA. So that gets extended on. Now, turns out, and I'll talk about this a little bit later, that there are acyl transferases that can transfer on a whole bunch of different side chains and make some really interesting products. The challenge with having a side chain is that it really restricts the mobility of the bond. And so when you make a plastic out of this, a polyester out of it, you're going to get something that's very stiff, which would be fine for the top on that plastic bottle, but maybe not for the bottle itself because you want to be able to squeeze it. So you might want to have a monomer that doesn't have a methyl group there. So how do you go in and remove that methyl group? Well, the way you do it is you change out this acyl transferase, which specifies what that side chain is going to be. And as I mentioned, there are a huge number of acyl transferases that will specify a huge number of different side chains, and that gives us huge flexibility in producing some really interesting polymers down the road. But for now, we just wanted that methyl group gone. Now, this has been done before. We're not the first ones to change out an acyl transferase. It was done here, in fact, 20 years ago. They took this erythromycin, PKS, and changed out the acyl transferase. They got a product that didn't have a methyl group here where it had one in the native product, but they got 5% of the activity that they started with. It didn't work. We didn't want that. We wanted an enzyme that would actually work. So we needed to find a way to specifically change that acyl transferase to one that doesn't specify a methyl group there, that specifies no methyl group. Okay, so I told you that we had structures for parts of these enzymes. We have structures actually for the KSAT di domain. And that structure is shown here. It's pretty complicated, but you can see pretty clearly where there are domains. Now, we just recently got this structure, and we wanted to figure out how we could do some exchanges, put these together. It's just like putting parts together, except in this way, we've got to have them all working together in a single enzyme. Now, here's what happened in the past. What happened in the past is when they transferred over that acyl transferase into the erythromycin cluster, they only brought over the part in red because that was the region that showed up in the sequence to be homologous. But what you see, once they did the crystal structure, they only brought part of it over. And it was pretty clear to us that maybe that was responsible for the loss in activity. So Satoshi Ozawa, a very talented postdoc in my lab, said, I think we're missing parts of this. We're missing the KSAT linker and the post-AT linker, basically the stuff right here in gray. So he made all of these constructs. So the ones in red are from a different PKS than the one we're substituting into. And he then looked at the activity of these. And the first thing he did was just try to purify them. Almost all of this data I'm showing you is in vitro data. And the first thing he noticed is that the purification yields varied dramatically. The one with this KSAT linker and post-AT linker purified very well. We got a lot of it out of purification. Some of these purified very poorly. Here's the one that had been done before, and you can see that we didn't get a lot of protein out of it. Well, it turns out that this is the one that had all of the activity, too. You can see here by the KCAT, it had a huge amount of activity, and so that's the one we chose. The next thing he said is, so here's the structure. We poured it over. Not too hard to see that this might be the best AT to transfer over. Now, the next thing he did is he wanted to say, well, this isn't just specific for this AT we transferred, that it works for other ATs. And so he tried that with five different ATs, transferring them over into the lipomycin PKS, that one that we've been working with to produce that 3-hydroxy acid. And you can see here the activities of those, and all except that rapamycin AT worked really well. In fact, some of these ended up having higher activity with the transferred acyl transferase than they did with the native acyl transferase. And that gave us the ability then to produce all of the same products, but now without that 2-methyl group. And so you could polymerize these and get polymers that would have very different properties. Okay, now I want to dive in a little bit here on the chemistry. And I'm sorry, this is the last talk. You were hoping for something lighter. But I don't want you to go home without some intense biochemistry here. So we're going to just do a little deep dive into the biochemistry of these enzymes because it's pretty cool. So the great thing about these enzymes, and the reason they're great for producing antibiotics is because they have a lot of stereospecificity. And that doesn't matter so much in polymers. There could be some polymers where it could be very important, some optical polymers. But for drugs, that is critical. And the acyl transferase is very specific for what it'll transfer on. It'll only transfer on an S-methylmalonyl group if you have that AT here. But then during the catalysis, the stereochemistry gets flipped by the KS. Now, the ketoreductase can also affect the stereochemistry. It can affect the stereochemistry here when it reduces that carboxyl to, or that keto to hydroxyl. It can also change the stereochemistry of the R group right there. And so we wanted to study that in more detail so that we could control it when we need to control it. Now, what I've just shown you here is that you do this condensation, you get the keto group here, and then you've got the KR that can give you all four of these different possibilities, where you have two antis and two syns. Okay? And Clara Eng, who's a graduate student in my laboratory, wanted to be able to control the stereochemistry. Now, it had been shown in the literature that you can swap in KRs and you can change it from anti to syn or from syn to anti. When you do this, you can retain the native activity. But what is really hard to do is change the stereo, or what was hard to do is change the stereochemistry of the 2-methyl group. It usually resulted in a huge loss of activity, just like with the acyl transferase. Now, what Clara noticed when she was doing these substitutions of the KR in the lipomycin PKS is that buried in them, they had what's called a dimerization element. And this looked to be important. And yet, when people were transferring over KRs, they were transferring over the whole thing. And so just to try to show you what a dimerization element might look like, it wasn't in this structure. This is an artist's rendition. I'm not covering up something naughty under here. This is actually where I envision the dimerization element might be, and that it's holding those dimers together so that they don't fall apart, so they can do their catalysis. Well, when we were moving over that ketoreductase, we were taking it with us from the native PKS, or from another PKS, and dropping it into this native PKS, or not retaining it at all. So the first thing Clara did is that she put in ketoreductases from various different polyketide synthases, and she left the dimerization element in the lipomycin PKS as we had it before, and voila, we can change the stereochemistry at each of these positions at will and retain the native activity. And more details can be found here. And that was the end of our biochemistry lesson. Okay, so let's talk about some other products that we can produce. And we actually didn't set out to produce these products, this next group of products, ketones. It kind of happened by accident. Ketones are really important. They're important solvents, so methyl ethyl ketone, ethyl ethyl ketone are used in huge quantities. And then there are some interesting flavors and fragrances that are methyl and ethyl ketones. And they actually make really great diesel molecules. And if you burned them in your diesel engine, your tailpipe would smell really sweet. how we found out that we were producing these and didn't really mean to is that Satoshi was doing the experiment in a test tube in vitro, and he forgot and left out the NADPH. And when you leave out the NADPH, the ketoreductase doesn't work, and you get a 3-keto group here. Now, that molecule is incredibly unstable. You just look at it wrong, and the CO2 will fall off. You add a little heat, and you can pretty much clear it off. And as a result of having this methyl branch here, you get ethyl ketones. Then you can go in, and he did the experiment where you change a single amino acid in the ketoreductase, you knock out the activity, and then you produce these inside the cell or in vitro with NADPH present, and you can produce lots of them. Well, now if you change that acyl transferase, as I showed you before, now it specifies a malonyl CoA rather than a methylmalonyl CoA. When you extend these, you get no methyl group here. This CO2 comes off, and you get the methyl ketones. So it gives us a way to produce a large number of different products that are used as solvents, but even some interesting flavor and fragrance molecules in the future. Okay, another molecule. I think this might actually be my last molecule, adipic acid. So adipic acid, huge amount of it used. It's used for producing nylon. And we get it from petroleum. In fact, you take benzene, you open up the ring, oxidize it, and you get the precursors to adipic acid. You reduce it, all the double bonds, and you can get adipic acid. Huge amounts produced worldwide, millions of tons, and it produces a lot of NOx, which gets into the atmosphere and has an environmental impact. So if you wanted to produce this with a PKS, the first thing you do is you start breaking it up into 2 carbon units. We can break it up here. You'd need then the load module, 2 extension modules, and a thioesterase. So we try to load on something like oxalyl CoA. Can't find it in the cell. You'd extend it with 2 molecules of malonyl CoA, and then you'd get your product off. Well, as I said, we can't really find no oxalyl CoA inside the cell. We might be able to make it. And we need 2 extension modules, and we really weren't up to 2 extension modules. So we said, how about we start with something else? Let's break off the 2 carbons at the end, but this would allow us to start with something that the cell has a lot of, and that is succinyl CoA. So you'd load on succinyl CoA, you'd extend it by 2 carbons with malonyl CoA, and then you'd get off your product. Okay. So this was Andrew Hagen's project. He was a graduate student in my lab, very good graduate student. But this was a very hard project. And I'll have to say that there are, since we started and finished this project, there are other ways to produce adipic acid that are out there that are even higher yielding. But I'll show you just after we discuss how we built this PKS, what we can do with kind of the chemistry that we've developed here. But we needed to find the modules, and what's even more, we needed to find a PKS that would allow a carboxyl group at this end. And there aren't that many if you look at polyketides. There are a couple. One of them is berylidin, and it has this carboxyl group right here at the end of the molecule, or at the start of the molecule where it was started to be synthesized. So we began with the berylidin PKS. And we knew that it loaded something like this at the very beginning because we could see it in the molecule. So we took the berylidin load and first extension module, and we coupled them to a thioesterase. The first thing Andrew did was to see if it would actually take succinyl CoA. We didn't actually know if it would. So here's the native substrate right here. Here's succinate loading on as succinyl CoA. And the strength or the thickness of the arrows indicates the amount of activity. And what you'll see is that succinyl CoA, with that as the starter, it actually had a higher activity with that than with the native substrate. So that was really great that that worked. However, it produced 3-hydroxy adipic acid, not adipic acid, because it only had a ketoreductase in it. And we needed a dehydratase and an inaugural reductase to get to our final product. So we were going to have to put that into this PKS that we had built. Now, this is called a reductive loop swap, where you take out the KR, and you swap in a KR, a DH, and an ER. Now, again, we don't have crystal structures for this, so we're kind of hunting in the dark. And so Andrew wanted to give himself the best possible chance, so he took four different antibiotic fully reducing domains, and he swapped them in for the KR. And lo and behold, he got no activity for what we wanted. It turned up 3-hydroxyadipic acid as a product for all of the constructs. But Andrew had a hint, and I can't quite remember how he discovered this, that the dehydratase wasn't working. I guess it was because that hydroxyl group is stuck there. And so he said, well, how about if I just supply this in trans? So everything else has been supplied in cis. This is where we have everything in one enzyme. But what Andrew did is now add the dehydratase in trans, just added purified dehydratase to the in vitro reactions, and he saw a little bit, a blip, of the adipic acid. And this gave us enough of a hint that something was wrong with that dehydratase. Then he substituted it in to our best clusters for the dehydratase in these two PKSs, and he got a lot of the adipic acid. And then when you put a thioesterase on, it kicks it off of the protein, and you get pure adipic acid. Not a lot, but enough to see. Now, I mentioned that other people have ways to produce adipic acid using biology, but what they don't have is a way to produce all of these different types of products. So what could be really great about this adipic acid synthase is you can now replace the AT, put in any side chain you want into that, and for instance, you could produce an adipic acid that has a double bond as a side chain. You could polymerize that into the polymers of nylon, and then you could cross-link them after the fact and have something that's much stronger or that would melt at a much higher temperature than the nylons we currently have. Okay, so finally, I want to just talk about in vivo work, because most of the work that I talked about was in vitro work, because these synthases are so large, it's been really challenging to express them functionally in an organism. And part of the problem is the organism that we were working with, E. coli. My lab has been addicted to E. coli for years, and lately to Saccharomyces cerevisiae. E. coli, as it turns out, produces a lot of insoluble protein when you produce these PKSs. Turns out the Saccharomyces is not that bad, but Streptomyces is even better. Now, the challenge with Streptomyces is they grow in a clumped way. They make these big balls when you have them in shake flasks. When you put them in fermenters, they have all these filaments, and you need a lot of power to beat them apart. And they are challenging to transform. The genetics aren't nearly so well developed. But this Streptomyces, called Streptomyces venezuelae, turns out that it's the E. coli of Streptomyces. It doesn't grow very clumped. It doesn't have filament very much. It's pretty readily transformable, and it has a doubling time of about 30 minutes in a really rich medium. So it grows quickly. But there weren't that many vectors for it, and so we had to go about creating vectors and find promoters for it. So Ryan Phelan developed a system, a series of expression vectors that integrate into a phage attachment sites. There are 3 on the chromosomes of these Streptomyces. Some of them have more. And you can use these for site-specific recombination and just drop your gene of interest with the promoter right into those locations. And as I said, Streptomyces venezuelae has 3 of them, and so Ryan built a whole series of expression vectors with associated promoters that he characterized using red fluorescent protein. And here's the expression from 2 of the sites, VWB and PhiC31, and basically you see that these bars are the same height over the same time periods. These sites work the same. The third site, 5BT1, we think is not a very good site, as evidenced by the data here. It's pretty crappy, actually. So we don't recommend using it. But all of these vectors are available at AdGene. You can just go on to AdGene, go on by my name, and you can get all of these vectors from them. They're all available. So how do they work? Well, we wanted to put a PKS in them, so we tried two PKSs. In fact, we built about 60 clones. In this case, we put them under a variety of different promoters in three different locations in two different strains. I didn't really talk about this Alba strain. It's an antibiotic producer. We used it as kind of a control. It's hard to transform, but we could transform it well enough with some of these. And we tried two PKSs. One has the native lip PKS, so that would produce this polyketide with the 2-methyl group, and this one has the AT-swapped mutant, so we wouldn't have a methyl group here in that 2 position. And these were in two different codon usages, the one for Streptomyces venezuelae and the one for E. coli. Okay, so this data is pretty hot off the press. And basically what you see here are the three different phage attachment sites. We see the different codon usages here, and this is having a 2-methyl group with the 3-hydroxyl there, and you can see that we got some production here. We're not talking very high production in Streptomyces venezuelae, but at least we are getting some pretty significant production, and we tried about 60 different strains in this case. We put it into Albus, this native antibiotic producer, and we get even more of our product, and as it turns out, now we're up to about 50 mg per liter, still a long way off what we would need for commodity chemicals and specialty chemicals, but we're getting there, and I think these are some of the highest levels for any hybrid PKSs that have been produced. So what I've shown you here is that we've constructed some PKSs that produce several commodity and specialty chemicals. We have determined some of the rules and structures for PKS recombination. We've begun to develop several new hosts for PKS and polyketide production, and these hosts produce modest amounts of the final products, but those products come off very pure without contamination of unwanted side products because of the nature of these PKSs. Now, this research was done by a very talented group of folks. This isn't my entire lab. This is the fuel synthesis division at JBay, which has my lab in it. And I've listed some of the folks here who've contributed to this research, and I thank them for their hard work. This work was funded under a number of grants, but really begun under SINBERC. So that, of course, was funded by the National Science Foundation. That we're producing fuels that is funded by the Department of Energy. Again, I just want to thank Doug and Kevin for organizing this great meeting. And the rest of the board of EBRC for the companies who are here who are supporting EBRC. It's an important outgrowth of SINBERC, and it's how we're continuing this great community forward and building it even stronger by bringing new people on board. And so I'm just so proud of what we've developed. And I look forward to the next retreat and coming there. And I thank you for your time and attention. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to take them.
Thanks, Jay. Questions for Jay?
They just want to go to the airport and go home.
Well, we got to get Julius to give another beer out. Going once, going twice. Okay, let's thank Jay again.
Thanks.
Okay, so with that, we'd like to close the public session. And so we thank both all of you here in the room and all of you on the webcast for your participation. And so with that, we'll end the public session here. Thank you very much.